How you doing, Instagram? It's Big Time Aran, and here's my thought of the day. Men rise from one ambition to another. First they seek to secure themselves against attack, and then they attack others. Ain't nothing but an old school way. Anyway, I'm here with my good friend, Big Time Olivia.
What's up, everybody? As many of you know, my great times a thousand grandfather's second cousin's former roommate's brother's wife moved to the Bronx from Italy in 1352. As a proud Italian-American, I take my heritage very seriously.
Very seriously.
And that's why today, on this episode of the Weird Medieval Guys podcast, we are going to go back in time to medieval Italy.
Take it easy.
Gabagool.
The feast is o'er. Now brimming wine in lordly cup is seen to shine before each eager guest. And silence fills the crowded hall, as deep as when the herald's call thrills in the loyal breast.
Back to the Weird Medieval Guys podcast, I'm Olivia, and this is Aran, an old-school Brooklynite who runs a bodega down on the corner.
Can I just say I'm so proud of you? This is your first stupid voice that you've done.
I do my best.
You've come so far.
Well, I just... The trick to a good New York voice is I just imitate my grandmother. You know, when I was a child, I thought she just talked like that. I didn't realize it was an accent that came from somewhere.
So when you met the second New Yorker, you were like, do you know my gram?
Yeah, literally. Anyways, and as you may have gathered from that meticulously crafted opening, today we are going to be talking about Italy.
Bella Italia.
Absolutely. And a couple podcasts ago, we did an episode about medieval humor and medieval jokes and medieval jesters,
mm-hmm.
and we shared some of our favorite jokes about Florence. Now, Florence was a favorite comedic subject in the Middle Ages.
The Florida of the Middle Ages.
Absolutely.
Florence man.
And we had a few comments. Some of them were asking us for more Florence jokes. Some of them were asking why Florence
jokes. Some of us were asking for fewer Florence jokes.
Some of them were asking why medieval people found Florence and Florentines so funny. And so today on the podcast, we're going to dig into Florence and medieval Florence and what made Florence such an interesting place that it became so such a subject of jokes and also just such a nexus of the medieval world, especially the late medieval world.
Yeah, because Florence is one of those places in this era that sort of not only now is like a huge topic of study. I mean, there's a whole field of history that's dedicated to the study of Florence in this one very specific time window. Like, people dedicate their entire lives to going to these dusty libraries in Italy to, like, you know, leaf through wills and try and figure out what that tells you about, like, family structure in 13th century Florence. And that's... your whole life can be that. But also, Florence was a place that lived large in the imaginations, not only of people in the modern era, but also at the time. It's just one of those sort of... it has this almost sort of mythic status, and I think that's well-deserved, because it's an incredibly complex and incredibly interesting society. So we're going to get into why people are obsessed with this goddamn town. I should say as well that we're trying something a bit new here at Weird Medieval Guys podcast for our 10th episode. This is the first of a sort of very intermittent, very unofficial series that we'll be doing about the great cities of the medieval world. And if you can't tell where that's going, you haven't been listening to this show long enough.
And if you have any cities as well, that you would like us to cover in the Middle Ages, then why not drop us a comment in the Spotify review box, and we'll consider your suggestions.
Yes, absolutely we will. And you better suggest some stuff, because if you don't, I'm going to make us do an episode about Norwich.
I'm going to make us do an episode about Hull.
Ooh.
Yeah, that's right.
So please save me from that.
Yeah.
No, Hull people, you're all right.
Yeah, keep telling them that.
On gentle Norman, think of wrong.
haven't listened to our episode on medieval jesters,
or just forgot, because it was a month ago,
or just forgot, then you might be asking, wait, what kinds of medieval jokes about Florence? Well, here are a couple. These are all from, I should mention, the Facetiae, which is an Italian joke anthology from the late 15th century. So, here we go. I knew an old Florentine bishop who had lost some of his teeth and complained of others being so loose that he was afraid they would soon fall out. Never fear, said one of his friends, they won't fall. And why not? Inquired the bishop. His friend replied, because my testicles have been hanging loose for the last 40 years, as if they were going to fall off, and yet, there they are still.
That got a laugh out of me.
You know, here's another good one.
Okay, hit me.
In Florence, I like that, like, these could just be jokes about anyone, but they're specifically people from Florence. In Florence, a young woman, somewhat of a simpleton, was on the point of delivering a baby. She had long been enduring acute pain, and the midwife, candle in hand, inspected her secret area in order to ascertain if the child was coming. Look on the other side, said the poor creature. My husband has sometimes taken that road. This is one about Tivoli, actually, not about Florence, but I just wanted to share this one with you guys as well.
Oh, they don't mind.
The good people of Tivoli were once harangued by an imprudent monk who thundered in a long, furious speech against the sin of adultery. Among other things, he declared that violation of the sanctity of wedlock was a crime of such grave character that he would rather lie with 10 virgins than one married woman.
Well, those are brilliant. I mean, obviously, those stand the test of time.
Yes.
But I think it's worth asking, why Florence? Because you mentioned, yeah, these could kind of be jokes about anybody anywhere.
Yeah.
So why is Florence looming so large in people's brains?
Well, I think a lot of it is to do with the ubiquity of Florence and how well-known Florence was, how big of a player it was in the late medieval social and political and economical landscape.
Yeah, I mean, so Florence grows over the course of the Middle Ages from being a pretty kind of backwater old Roman town into being one of the largest cities in Europe at the time. And we'll get into why that happens in excruciating detail later. But the other thing that's important about Florence is that it is an incredibly important cultural center. Many people argue that it is the site where the Renaissance kicks off. Dun, 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 dun.
Woo! Everyone loves the Renaissance.
The most important thing that's ever happened in the history of anything ever.
The part of history when people became smart and interested in the arts again. as we know, as we've discussed many a time.
So let's peel back what the Renaissance is and what it isn't. The Renaissance, as sort of colloquially defined, you might say, is very confusing because it's used as both a self-conscious intellectual movement and also a period of history. So as a period of history, it's usually sort of understood to have started at the end of the 14th century and swung all the way into the 17th. It was defined in this narrative by a rediscovery and re-interest in the classical world, by a rise in secular culture, and by distinctive changes in the artistic traditions of the time.
Well, yeah, so we won't get into sort of why exactly medieval art looks the way it does, but when
we have a podcast about that.
We do. It's actually one of our... It is our first podcast episode, yes. Is it not?
So just scroll down.
Yes.
And then come back to this one.
Exactly. Stop, pause, scroll down, listen, and then pick up right here. So when a lot of people see medieval art, a lot of people today, often their first impression and the first response they have to the artwork is, well, why doesn't it look realistic? Mm-hmm. Why isn't it anatomically accurate? And also why, in terms of the human subjects, and also why do many of the animal subjects look a bit strange? And why is there a seeming lack of attention to things like perspective and scale that make an entire scene look more realistic?
And might I add, there's another trend, which is the anachronistic depictions of the pre-medieval classical past. So you have, like, I don't know, like Caesar standing next to a pope or whatever.
Exactly.
Something that would have never happened. Yeah. Because yeah. Christianity did not exist.
Wearing a big floppy hat and exactly. a doublet.
Exactly.
And, you know,
exactly.
pointy shoes.
Saying, I love Jesus.
Yes! Me too, Caesar.
So yeah, as you quite rightly say, people look at this and they go, why is medieval art so weird? People do that in the comments section of your Twitter account.
Yes.
Every goddamn day.
With great gusto.
With great gusto. And this is usually... The weirdness of medieval art is often contrasted with the trends that you see in the quote-unquote Renaissance period. You see a move towards less stylized depictions of the human form and of nature. You see a move towards more depictions of sort of not explicitly religious themes. You see depictions of the classical past and events from classical mythology depicted in a non-Christian way. So basically, the Renaissance kills the weird medieval guy.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Now, as ever in history, that's quite an oversimplified sort of... That's painting a very broad brush about the Renaissance. And in many ways, I think, overstating the levels of difference that you
Absolutely.
See.
Absolutely. I think especially a lot of people also ascribe... A lot of people also assume that these... changes in artistic style corresponded to a change in overarching sort of philosophy as well. So oftentimes what people think is that medieval people were wholly disinterested in the classical worlds and the ancient worlds.
Not true. We spent an hour and a half on that.
And that people became more interested in these things again. They sort of just magically rediscovered them at the end of the Middle Ages and decided to become interested in Greek and Roman philosophy again. So as we have said before, that's absolutely not true.
No.
Medieval people loved ancient philosophy.
They were at least as obsessed with it as people in the early modern period. I mean, we have a whole episode about this.
Yeah, exactly.
it is the single most important cultural reference point other than the Bible in the medieval world. There's no way around that. What does happen at the sort of tail end of the, especially at the tail end of the 15th century, is not that the classical past is sort of rediscovered, but more that there is a bit of an intellectual reframing of the classical past. So what the very important thing that happens at the end of the 15th century is that there are a lot of works that are rediscovered, mostly from the Hellenistic period, so the Greeks, rather than the Romans. And to take the classic example, in the pre-Renaissance medieval world, there was only one scrap of one parchment by Plato, right? And then all of a sudden, by the end of the 15th century, there are quite a few works circulating around Europe and being copied everywhere by people who are like, this Plato guy is amazing! This is crazy! The reason why those works get quote-unquote rediscovered is because in the intervening period between the fall of the Roman Empire and the Renaissance, scholars in the Arab world and in the Byzantine Empire have been studiously studying them and translating them, but not really translating them to anything other than Greek and Arabic. And so when you have, at the end of the 15th century, an influx of Byzantine scholars fleeing the collapsing Roman Empire, and you have the gradual sort of receding of the Arab influence in Europe who leave behind a whole lot of texts and whole libraries of works that have been very studiously translated into Arabic and studied for centuries. The combination of those two things leads to significant amounts of material that wasn't available before suddenly being available to Latinate audiences.
Yeah, exactly, because even though certain authors like Plato weren't widely read in the Middle Ages, there were certainly classical authors who they were very, very interested in and who mm-hmm. were frequently read, like Boethius and Aristotle and Julius Caesar's works. They loved Boethius. He invented the Wheel of Fortune. He did. He was medieval Alex. Well, he was classical Alex Trebek. Boethius was cool. He was the first guy to be like, what if fortune was not an abstract concept, but a really hot lady.
What if?
And I respect him for that.
Yeah, I...
You know, now we have lady luck.
I think more abstract concepts should be hot babes.
Yeah, me too. And of course, the idea that the Renaissance was the first time that people... I mean, okay, you know what? Let's do the stupidest thing possible. Let's dig into what the word Renaissance means.
Oh, God.
Yes, it means renaissance. So the idea...
We have 500 years of Florence to get through.
So the idea is, you know, that there was this sort of, you know, golden age of Greek and Roman philosophy and Greek and Roman output, and that this was brought back in the Renaissance. Of course, this is a term that's been applied post hoc to the period that we know as the Renaissance.
I'd actually go a little bit further. I would say that it's not just something that people have applied in retrospect, but it is essentially the way that the scholars in this period thought about themselves. The Renaissance describes their self-concept rather than an actual neutral term. It's basically propaganda for the 15th century.
And it also falsely assumes that this is the first time that there was an interest in realigning art and culture with the ancient world. This is not the case at all. So notably, for instance, the Carolingian Renaissance in around the 9th century was a massive revival of Greek and Roman culture. I mean, it's worth also mentioning that the dominant style of art for the first part, for most of the Middle Ages, until Gothic art and architecture, which started around the 12th or 11th century, was called Romanesque.
Mm-hmm.
So everyone was making art that essentially imitated Roman art in one way or another. Everyone is, of course, a bit of an overstatement, but and so the Carolingian Renaissance, in which what's his name, Charles Magnus, Big Chuck, Charlemagne, that's him. Yeah, thanks for letting me flounder with that one.
I was enjoying where you were going.
So Charlemagne basically as well consciously tried to revive ancient Greek and Roman art styles and philosophy. And if you look at art not just from that specific time period, but from a lot of the earlier Middle Ages and a lot of art from Italy in general throughout the Middle Ages, you actually see that there was never a full abandonment of some of these Greek and Roman principles of art, such as anatomy and greater attention to historical accuracy. So for instance, medieval Italy, there's actually lots of art from all over the Middle Ages where people are drawing people in togas and people have very like naturalistic poses and lighting and, you know, anatomy and perspective. It's very, very interesting.
And it's not as if, on the flip side of that, it's not as if people in the Renaissance period were above anachronism either.
Exactly.
As we talked about in our episode where we talked about what the medieval world thought about the classical world, we did make the comparison point of Shakespeare plays.
Yes.
Which are wildly anachronistic in terms of the way that they sort of presented dress. People were parading around in like big floppy hats with the ostrich feathers.
Definitely.
Pretending to be Romans.
Yeah, and funnily enough, the ancient peoples were not above these anachronisms either, and a lot of those are very pervasive even today. Because if you think of, for instance, Achilles, what do you think of?
His
you
heel. Think,
yes, definitely. And after that, you think of his helmet, right?
Yes.
Which is I forget what it's called, a hoplite or something. I don't know anything about classical history. That is a helmet from the time period when Achilles' story was written. Achilles was a...
Oh, shit.
Mycenaean, I don't know anything.
Mycenaean?
He was a Mycenaean. Okay, listen, my lack of classical historical knowledge is gonna come in hot for a few minutes, but just ignore it. He was, in the story, a Mycenaean Greek, you know, who lived hundreds of years before anyone made those funny helmets with the brooms on top. And he would have worn a comparatively, I think to us, somewhat goofy-looking, rather conical helmet that was covered in boar tusks.
Yes.
And
that would have looked rad!
And it's super badass, but because we think of the hoplite as the quintessential Greek soldier, we can't imagine Achilles and a lot of other classical Greek figures as wearing anything but this sort of very typical helmet.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'll link some pictures of Mycenaean helmets because they are so cool.
So there you go. The Renaissance was more of a change in emphasis.
Yeah.
And we have to tread very carefully when we talk about it, because it's very easy to fall into the trap of assuming that the way that people thought about themselves and their own place in history was actually accurate. Yes. So you'll see a lot of people in this period writing about, we've just rediscovered the classical past, when, as we've talked about extensively, the classical past was living with the medieval with the medieval world for the entirety of the medieval period.
Not to drag this on too much, but I think that we think of things like anatomy and perspective and sort of, you know, scale as being the baseline default state for art. Artists are generally trying to be as accurate to real life as possible, and there must be an explanation when they're not. So we need to explain why they would deviate from that. But it's also, I think, worth noting...
It's because they hate beauty.
Yes.
And they want to depress the human soul. We'll get into that.
Exactly. But I think if you look back at art such as, you know, not just medieval art, but also classical Greek and Roman art, things like paintings as sort of single entities, just having a painting in a frame, that's actually not a very ubiquitous thing until we get to the so-called Renaissance, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
A lot of art forms are frescoes and altarpieces and religious artwork and sculptures, and they're often sort of very heavily iconographic, and we're not necessarily always criticizing them as much as we might criticize a painting or something else that looks anatomically inaccurate or otherwise inaccurate.
So that's the Renaissance. Not exactly what you think it is, but still pretty important. And a super interesting period in history.
Here is his servant who dies on the field. Let servants all of it hear and hereafter. Living in death the man.
And of course, Florence was in many ways the sort of the breeding ground for a lot of these ideas. So many of the iconic Renaissance characters, whether they're writing literature or doing big paintings, either come from Florence or work in Florence for significant periods of their professional lives.
People like Leonardo DiCaprio.
Fuck you. Donatello. Michelangelo.
Who's Donatello? She's hot.
Oh my god. I was about to make a Ninja Turtles joke.
Sorry, do you wanna, just
no, you know what?
Do you want to take
you.
It from the top?
No,
I'm sorry.
I don't. The moment's past. This is all staying in. This is, so you people can see what I have to deal with.
Wow, I'm such a scoundrel. That was malevolent. Wow. Boccaccio.
Boccaccio. Oh my god. Boccaccio, his Decameron, which is both really good and also interminable.
You might remember it as the source of Parmesan Mountain.
Oh, yes.
Yes. Dante.
And his buddy Petrarch.
Yes.
Fun fact about Petrarch, who was a Florentine scholar. He was one of these people who was obsessed with Rome. He famously said,
what else is all history but the praise of Rome?
He even wrote letters to dead authors like Cicero, people who've been dead for thousands of years, and he says that he addressed them
with a familiarity springing from my sympathy with his genius.
This guy was writing fan mail to Cicero.
Did you almost say fan fiction?
I did almost write Cicero fanfic. Quickly, pull up AO3 to see if that exists.
Yes.
Please don't.
Oh my god.
So those are the few of the great men of the Florentine Renaissance. But I think we have a responsibility on Weird Medieval Guys to tell a bit more of an interesting story than just the lives of a couple of very, admittedly, very clever and very successful and very accomplished artists. So I think what would be useful to do for the rest of this episode is to dive into the history of Florence as a city and explain why exactly it was the perfect petri dish for the intellectual developments and the cultural developments that would spread like wildfire across Europe.
Yes, I agree.
Never in danger, quail at our fathers, free and unguarded, exalt our renown.
So before we talk about Florence itself, I think we need to first of all understand the political context of medieval Italy. Because medieval Italy is, for want of a slightly less maudlin comparison, it's a bit like the sort of Eastern Europe of the Middle Ages, because it is sandwiched between two massively powerful power blocks. Far to the north, in the German lands, you have the Holy Roman Emperor, the primus inter pares of the Christian world, the first among equals, and the ruler of the mightiest state. Italy was nominally under the sovereignty of the Holy Roman Emperor. One of the Holy Roman Emperor's titles was King of Italy. But the reality was far more complex. Italy is far away from Germany, and it's over some mountains. You may have heard of them, called the Alps, the Toblerones.
Yes.
And not only is it far away from the center of power in the empire, but there's also a rival to the imperial throne. Big Daddy Pope himself. So Rome is the beating heart of the Latin Christian world. It is the center, not only the spiritual center, the most important religious site in the Christian world, but it's also the center of the church bureaucracy. And as we've explored in other episodes, most notably our divorce episode, the bureaucracy of the church is by the high Middle Ages an incredibly powerful institution. It reached into every bedroom in Christendom.
Wow.
Regulating moral behavior, regulating what kings could do. The Pope could write a fucking papal bull to excommunicate a king.
Yeah.
That would fuck his entire country for a decade. And not only that, but the papacy is the center of a huge financial empire. Because, of course, the church demands tithes. And the bankers at the papal court get to control where that money goes. So the Pope can build cities, he can raise armies, he's an incredibly powerful person. And that's particularly problematic for the Holy Roman Emperor for two reasons. So first of all, the Holy Roman Emperor was crowned by the Pope, which meant that he was neither holy nor Roman without papal approval. And, to make matters worse, he was also elected by a different electorate from the Holy Roman Emperor. The Holy Roman Emperor is, of course, elected by the various, you know, kings and princes of the empire. The Pope is elected by the cardinals, as he is to this day. So that means that you have an independent power center that's able to project influence all over the continent, but especially in its own backyard, which is already a really hard area for you to control. And so these two great powers are sort of eyeing each other enviously over the Alps, sort of staring each other down and constantly getting into scrapes. They are constantly feuding. They are having controversies, with a capital C. They have wars, often about who gets to appoint bishops, for example. So who gets to control, you know, can the monarchy control the religious institutions in their own country? The answer is often no. Because of that, northern Italy is a bit of a no man's land between these two great powers. And what that means is neither of them can afford to let the other one become too dominant in the region, but also no independent power center apart from those two powers can be allowed to emerge in that region, apart from the Empire and the Pope. All right? Following so far?
Mm-hmm.
It's going to get more complicated.
Good.
So what you get instead are cities, the communes. These are, you know, very small-scale political units of a city and then its immediate countryside, the contado, that it controls. And these cities, each of them, have their own incredibly complicated, constantly evolving relationship with the empire, with the pope, and with each other. And these communes are places that you will have heard of. Places like Milan.
Venice.
Genoa. And the biggest and sexiest of them all.
Florence. Firenze.
That's right, that is what it's called. You really are embracing your Italian heritage.
I have to say, Florence, best Duomo in Italy.
Oh, controversial.
I love the green.
I've always been a big fan of Torino.
Oh, I haven't actually been to that one. I was hoping you weren't going to say Milan, because I think, like, you're a total cuck if you think Milan has the best Duomo.
There's another side effect, though, of this political fracturing that you see within each one of these communes, though. The politics of each one of those communes is determined by what side of that geopolitical fault line you think your city should fall on. And in every single city in Italy, pretty much, two parties were formed. The Guelphs, who supported the papacy, and the Ghibellines, who supported the empire. And some, you know, the relative strength of each one of those parties varied depending on the city. Some cities were reliably Guelph, some cities were reliably Ghibelline, and some, like Florence, sort of fluctuated wildly year by year based on who was in power at any given time and what was in the best interests of the city.
Americans will know these as swing states.
Florence, the Pennsylvania of, yes! of medieval Italy. That's the world in which Florentines find themselves in the Middle Ages. This incredibly chaotic, incredibly confusing world of constantly shifting alliances between these Italian city-states and the papacy and the empire. But that's the background. Let's talk about Florence itself. Because Florence in the Middle Ages is all about one thing. There's one engine that runs the Florentine economy. Would you like to tell them what it is?
Lana,
your favorite thing in the world, judging by the contents of your living room.
Wool, yes. I do have several kilograms of fleece in my living room right now.
I am surrounded by wool. If you want to imagine what this room is like, there's just like big piles of wool everywhere. Some of it's being spun right now. Some of it's
been turned into garments.
Yeah,
some of it's been dyed. Some of it is just strewn in bits around the place.
It's a wool lover's paradise. It's like a body horror movie for a sheep.
Yeah, exactly.
You turned my hair into a shirt!
Yeah, definitely. So, wool is hugely important as the fiber that makes the clothing that people wear. Wool is...
Both for normal people and for the rich.
Yes, because there's varying grades of wool. You can have really crap wool, which is wool... where the fibers of the wool themselves are very coarse, or you can have very nice wool. Wool, importantly as well, is a really high margin thing to produce and sell for the people who own the sheep, okay?
Right.
So most of the wool that's being processed in Florence is coming in from England, at least in the beginning.
Uh-huh.
And so sheep, they're pretty hardy creatures, right? They don't need a lot. They don't demand a lot from their owners.
They're pretty chill.
You can have a lot of them. They just eat grass. They grow the wool without really you needing to do anything, which is nice. So
Don't lose them.
Yeah. Unlike crops, you know, there's a less chance of your sheep sort of just dying or getting a fungus. And wool is also really economical to pack and ship. So we were talking about, in our Doritos episode, about how certain things like salt, despite not being something that was really rare in places where you couldn't ship it, it was stupidly expensive because you're basically just shipping rocks. So you can actually pack in quite a few kilos of wool. It compresses very easily. It actually compresses much more easily than, for instance, spun thread or fabric or garments. And so in the beginning, sort of around the High Middle Ages, it was very economical for these English people, these sheep owners, to just shear their sheep and then, without doing anything else, just pack up all of that wool and sell it to merchants who would bring it to Italy.
What yeah, you so saw what with you the wool trade was a continent-wide supply chain. Where what you saw with the wool trade was a continent-wide supply chain.
Usually in the Low Countries,
where
cities
like wool would be brought to merchants
and
in sort of
Antwerp. Usually in the Low Countries,
and then those merchants would bring a lot of that wool all the way to Italy,
and then those merchants would bring.
And Florence, by being on the end of that supply chain, was in a very advantageous position.
Yeah, because even though the people who are selling the wool are making a tidy profit, they're not selling it for a stupid amount of money. And importantly, when you buy the wool, by turning it into fabric, you are raising the value of those materials exponentially.
Well, because it's an incredibly labor-intensive process, as well you know.
Exactly. And so, but this is the important thing, is once you have the raw materials, in terms of the wool, you need dye as well at the end. Once you have the raw materials, the amount of money you can make off of those raw materials, the net profit, the profit margin, is determined by how cheaply you can process that wool into nice fabric.
Uh-huh. And surprise, bitch, this is an economics episode.
Yep.
Settle in. We reeled you in with jokes, and now we're doing profit margins and production lines.
Exactly. So before we get into the nitty-gritty of wool production, which, of course, I'm just dying.
I promise this is interesting. Okay, right.
No.
This is all going somewhere.
And so in Florence, you had a lot of people employed in the wool industry.
Yep. It was probably, aside from agriculture, the biggest employer in the commune of Florence. And there were lots of different jobs that needed to be done in the wool production process, because it's, like I say, it's an incredibly complex and labor-intensive process.
So steps that are involved. Okay, once you have the wool, you're getting this raw wool. It's basically sort of a greasy pile of, like, loose dreadlocks. No, sheep are seriously oily, right?
They are
covered in oil.
I've worked on a farm. So don't at me.
So you get this giant pile of dreadlocks, basically, sheep dreadlocks.
Ugh.
And first you need to just dig your hands in and start sorting them, start picking out some of the material and detangling this mass of fibers into something that's a bit less gross. And after that, it's time to card your wool. So this is, you basically take, like, big combs and you comb out the wool into a sort of even mass, something that basically, and sort of make sure the fibers are aligned and detangled so that they can be spun.
Uh-huh.
And then you can spin it, put it on a loom after that, and weave it into fabric. And then there's, after that, actually, there's a huge process. You would think maybe, oh, once you have the fabric, that's done. But there's a huge process of, like, different things you have to do. So often, like, the fabric will be a bit lumpy, so you have to, like, comb it and trim it and do all these different things to it. This is just a hugely labor-intensive process. So I read a paper saying that in order to make a standard medieval bolt of cloth, which would be enough to make about, by my estimates, about 60 sort of garments, if you're thinking of, like, knee-length tunics, for instance. So in order to make enough fabric for that from the raw wool, it would take 30 people approximately 5 weeks.
Jesus Christ.
So I said bolt of cloth. This was specified as a piece of cloth measuring 42 by 4 L's. So I really like that as a unit of measurement. And I was reading about other medieval units of measurement.
I'm off to get some L's.
Yeah, exactly.
That's what I say every day before I go to work.
Yeah. These are mostly units of distance. You might have heard of a barley corn and a poppy seed, which are like the medieval sort of centimeter and millimeter.
I have not.
Okay, well, there's a twip. Yes! There's a distance. This is still used. A lot of these are actually still used in various contexts. A furlong.
Oh, okay.
Might be something you've heard of. That's officially the distance a plow team can plow without stopping for rest.
Wow, so a variable.
Yes.
Fantastic.
Yes. and then you also have a unit of measurement. This is, I think, post-medieval, but I really liked it, so I'm including it anyways. It's called Gunter's chain. And it's a distance...
Gunter!
It's a distance based on a chain made by a guy named Gunter. It was just a guy named Gunter who was like, we need a standardized unit of measurement, so he made a chain.
If nobody else is going to fucking do it, I'll do it myself.
Yep, exactly.
Here you go. There's my chain. Gunter's chain.
Yep. And then you have Gunter's links, which are the length of one link in each of these chains, which, yeah, is, I think, really, really wonderful.
I need to know everything about this man.
I know. Gunter. I think he was English, actually. But anyways.
Are you going to make me a long chain? And we're going to use it for measuring sheeps.
Exactly.
I've been listening to a lot of Wurzels lately.
Yeah, I know. I've been there.
Don't pretend you haven't enjoyed it.
So anyways, if any of these steps are messed up, by the way, in making this fabric, then the final value of the fabric is severely impacted. So you really want people doing each of these things who know what they're doing and can also do it quickly and reliably.
Honor in my dress, hope and refuse.
You might be asking yourself, if all of that manual labor is involved in producing a comparatively small amount of fabric, right, then how is it that the people who are at the top of this operation controlling it are making healthy profits while also making sure that everyone else is being fairly compensated for their time and their skills?
Well, that's the neat part. You don't do the last bit.
Yeah.
So, a really important thing to understand about the way that the wool trade worked is, as Olivia mentioned, there are lots of different people involved in this process. And by the way, there's even more of a profit incentive, because until really the 13th century, that production line is not vertically integrated. So it's a bunch of middlemen, all of whom have to make themselves a profit, which means that the actual hard labor being done by the workers has to be as cheap as possible. Now, in the Middle Ages, if you were an artisan, a skilled worker, basically, and I use that term advisedly, you were more likely than not a member of a guild. And Florence, being the center of what passed for industry in the Middle Ages, had a lot of fucking guilds. The largest of which was the Arte de Lana, the wool guild, imaginatively named.
So you might be thinking at this point, oh, all of these people who work in the wool industry must have been in this wool guild. Incorrect. Almost none of them did. So, I was reading that, I don't know the exact date on this, but in medieval Florence, of around 14,000 people involved in the wool industry. Actually, let's make this a game. Aran, do you know how many of those people were eligible for membership in the wool guild?
I have read those notes, but I forgot. I'm going to say 400.
200. So, yeah. So most of the people that are in this industry are shut out from the guilds.
And the guilds are an incredibly important part of industrial relations in the Middle Ages. It's a combination of... It's where you collectively bargain to set wages. It's where you will learn your trade in many cases because, you know, you learn from other guildsmen.
Mm-hmm. These are the people who are often deciding who was allowed to practice this trade in the first place.
It's basically a mix between a trade union, a professional association, a technical college, and the mob.
Yes.
And in Florence, membership of a guild was even more important than in the rest of Europe, because Florence, from 1115 onwards, was what historians call a guild republic. So your political rights were determined by whether or not you were a member of a recognized guild. To take a step back and explain how you get there, basically pre-1115, Florence is ruled by the Podesta, who is an aristocratic papal appointee. Anyway, there's a bit of a power vacuum after one of them dies, and basically the guilds, who, whilst relatively small in number, do represent the richest people in Florence, say, well, there's a bit of a power vacuum here, we could stage a coup. And so in the absence of the Podesta, they set up a new constitution, basically, with a new system of government. And it's a bafflingly weird system of government to a modern listener. So, for example, the way that it worked is the executive was comprised of the Gonfalonieri di Giustizia, who was the standard bearer of justice, who was like the head of government, and nine signori, who were basically like the cabinet. And those people were elected by lottery every 2 months.
That's quite a turnover rate, isn't it?
Imagine just for a second, please, if you will, if, never mind your own country, the prime minister changed every 2 months and was just a random guy from your town. Even if it was in your city, if the mayor was elected every 2 months.
That would be nuts.
And it could be your idiot cousin.
Oh, no. Oh, that's a sad thought.
And in order to be in that lottery, you had to, as a bare minimum, be a member of a guild. And I should say, also say that the guilds had two legislative chambers as well as part of this constitution, where they had to approve all legislation that was passed in the commune.
Madness. And so the people that were doing the carding and the spinning and the cleaning and the weaving of these fabrics, of the wool, were not allowed in the guild. So who was?
I mean, basically, like, the very sort of the...
The merchants.
The merchants, the sort of the upper end of the production chain, so the people who are doing the very sort of fine work, but not your industrial workers, the people who are, like, working in... Not your builders, not your wool carders, not your butchers.
Maybe your dyers.
Wait, yeah, the dyers do have their own guild.
Yes.
And they're very militant.
Yes, well, you would be too if you knew how tricky it was to get a decent dye out of a plant.
And dyeing, by the way, smelled fucking terrible.
Yes, absolutely. And it needed all sorts of, like, weird chemicals. And I mean, it still does, to be honest.
So you would be going a little bit insane.
Definitely. It was like a real Mad Hatter scenario.
So here's a fun fact for you, by the way. I mentioned that it's not vertically integrated until the 14th century. That does change in an event that historians call the Underwear Revolution.
Yes!
Basically, what happens is... basically, there are advances in spinning that allow you to spin a much finer cloth. And suddenly people are like, that would feel really nice against my so-and-so. Are you okay?
Yeah.
And so underwear becomes much more popular as a luxury good.
I want to put this on my weenie.
You okay?
Yeah. I'm gonna put this on my Vegeta. Sorry.
Oh dear. And so that changes the work that goes into the production of woolen garments, which means that it's an opportunity for the people at the top to renegotiate the economic relationships that produce this wool. And so what you see is a much more vertically integrated system where people are working more and more for bosses rather than being independent contractors who come in and sell their wool to the next guy in the supply chain, which allows people to make much more money at the top, and it puts the people who are at the bottom in a much more precarious position because they no longer have an ability to negotiate.
Yeah, I think it's to give a bit of cultural background as well that's maybe not important for understanding each individual event, but is maybe important for understanding, some of the ubiquity, but also disenfranchisement of wool workers, is that wool and spinning were not necessarily looked upon as sort of fine arts or high arts or skilled labor in the Middle Ages. And so we get a lot of depictions typically of women spinning, and so there's a conception definitely that spinning was more of a woman's task. This isn't necessarily 100% the case, so there were of course a lot of men involved in commercial spinning and commercial wool production.
We're gonna meet some of them in a bit.
Yes, but a lot of these jobs like carding and spinning and even weaving to an extent, although weaving was a little bit more, you know, highbrow, They were things that people often did as a kind of piecework. There was, you know, a bit of a gig economy in a lot of places, to be honest.
No, it's a really good analogy.
Where people wouldn't necessarily be employed full-time as weavers or spinners, but it could be something that you did, for instance, on the side to make a bit of money. Of course, this was less the case in Florence, where there was a more robust trade. But the idea of the people who make the garments that you wear and make the fabric that you wear, despite being an important part, you know, of people's life, even people at the very top of the economic chain, and yet these people being sort of completely disenfranchised, is sort of a product to an extent of how we view this type of labor and how this type of labor was viewed, I should, you know, say in the past tense more, but I think it's also worth pointing out that, like, the status of garment workers has not necessarily changed significantly.
No.
You imagine, if you've bought a new piece of clothing in the past, you know, 20 years, if you imagine who made that and how they were compensated, you know, as much as I think it can be easy to be like, oh my gosh, how are these, you know, people all getting taken advantage of like this in Florence? Well,
so the important thing about a major city like Florence in this period is that it doesn't have a self-sustaining population. Cities are fucking horrible for disease, as anybody who's taken the London Underground will understand.
Even in the pre-bedbug era.
I mean, by the time this goes out, we could have been eaten by bedbugs. I don't know. Anyway, so cities like Florence sustained their population through constant migration from the rural parts of its immediate environs into the city. Who these people were, in the bluntest possible terms, rural people who were being displaced and pulled by the economic center of gravity more and more into this black hole, essentially, that will chew you up and spit you out. It's not a good situation to be in. The pay is shit. The hours are incredibly long. 14 hours a day, a lot of the time.
Jesus.
Yeah, no, it's, but unfortunately, that's where the money is. And by the way, this is something that gets replicated all over the world. When industrialization really starts to pick up pace, even that life is in many ways easier and more convenient than potentially, you know, getting impaled by a spike on a farm and dying in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, or just starving to death because your crops fails, which is something that, you know, happened all the way up, even, you know, in Europe, all the way up to the 19th and the 20th century. So in Florence, in the Middle Ages, you saw this confluence of all of these different people who were industrial workers, in a sense. And while there were other big cities in the Middle Ages, of course, it was, I think, Florence very unique for having this very large concentration of industrial workers.
Mm-hmm. And a concentration of industrial workers leads to a second thing, which is the concentration of capital. We talked in the Doritos episode about how if you make your money, your living, from trade, you're going to have more liquid assets, more money floating around, than somebody who sort of subsists through agriculture. Because, you know, you sell stuff, you're buying stuff and selling stuff, and that there's many more cash transactions in that process than there is in a purely agricultural economy. So what you see in Florence is a gradual accumulation of capital. People and families in particular, these big, they're called tower families, because here's a fun fact about Florence. The aristocratic families of Florence, they lived in these towers. The whole family would live in the same tower, and every member of the family owned shares in that tower, and to sell the shares, you needed the unanimous consent of all other members of the family, so you literally could not leave unless your parents said so, which, I mean, there's a joke about Italians that I'm choosing not to make.
Well, yeah, especially in light of that court case, right? That was in the news.
Woman evicts her 40 and 42-year-old sons.
Yeah, because they were employed but didn't pay rent. Didn't do any housework. This was in Italy.
Oh, dear.
Roland, great spirit, look down on our standards.
So there's all this money floating around in Florence, and the Florentine elite are getting very rich. But there's another thing going on as well, which is that as this process is happening in Florence, Florence is the sharp end of this process. It's on the cutting edge, but it's happening in lots of other places as well. The 10th to the 14th centuries in Italy sees what historians call the Commercial Revolution, a period of increased international trade centered on Italy. So rivals to Florence, like Venice and Genoa, get fabulously rich by controlling trade in the Mediterranean. The Genoese take the western half, and as we've talked about before, the Venetians take the eastern half. And Florence is stuck in the middle with no seaport. So Florence has to find a way to compete with these other cities and project its influence in another way. And the Florentines, instead of going east or west, they go north. They go it in a very different way than everybody else. They do banking. These great families, like the Albizzi and the Strozzi, and yes, the Medici, if you were waiting to cross that one off your medieval Florence bingo card, congratulations. Yes. I think that's a world record. Anyone's gone talking about medieval Florence without talking about the Medici family. So all these great families, they set up these vast banking empires that have branches in cities all across Europe, and they are crucial in the financial markets. They are who you go to if you want to fight a war. And they, a lot of the time, they do those banking transactions in their own currency, the gold florin.
Yeah, so after the fall of Rome and the subsequent disruption of trade, gold became a lot harder to get, and gold coins, for a very long time, stopped being minted.
Well, there's fewer of
them. There's fewer of them, and they were not widely circulated until Florence and its florin.
Yeah, they basically got access to a whole bunch of mines in Hungary, and they started minting these gold coins, and suddenly those are being used in transactions all across the continent.
And Hungarians saw them and were like, oh, we want to do that too. Let's change the name a little bit.
Let's change two letters.
Okay, let's call it the forint.
And that's how you get the Hungarian forint, everybody.
Fun fact.
Fun facts. That's what we do here. And so in some ways, the answer to why people would be making jokes about Florentines across Italy is because there was a good chance, if you were an educated sort of person in business, you would probably have met Florentines, have done business with them, and probably resent them because nobody likes their bank.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
And so sticking it to the Florentines.
Yeah, it's like if Lloyd's Bank, you
don't
know.
Don't name a specific bank.
RBS.
No, cut this. It's like if unnamed bank, who I don't want to get on the wrong side of.
What's another bank? And Santander were just like five guys who were all friends with each other, you know? You would start to resent the place that had, you know, brought those guys forth into the world.
Probably the most well-known, though, and the most influential of these great banking families was, as I've mentioned before, the Medici. Now, the Medici, and I'm going to pronounce it every which way over the course of this episode, because that way I can't be wrong. At the start of the 15th century, the Medici are, in many ways, a fairly standard Italian banking dynasty, until the head of that family, Giovanni de Medici, makes a very important choice. He chooses to finance the Pope's return from Avignon to Rome, where the Pope had been living for like almost a century because of aforementioned political strife. And in doing so, he made a very, very good bet, because in exchange, once the Pope had returned to Rome, he gave the Medici very expensive contracts to manage all of the tax income that the papacy was in charge of, which meant that the Medici got very, very, very wealthy, and their bank got enormously large. Now, meanwhile, back in Florence, Florence's constant conflicts and wars with other Italian powers and with, you know, other factions were bankrupting the state, and it was getting more and more politically impractical to add new taxes to pay for these wars. So the government in Florence became more and more dependent on these great banks. In many ways, you know, the Florentine Republic had sort of raised and reared these institutions, and now sort of comes begging to these multinational corporations to finance their activities. Completely unlike the political economy of the modern world, of course.
Yes, that would never happen.
Yeah. Now that's all right, actually, for the Florentines, as long as the banking sector doesn't get too consolidated. But hypothetically, if one bank were to become extremely large and powerful and provide the majority of the loans, they would be able to, they would basically have the entire Florentine government over their knee, which is exactly what happened. By the 1430s, 46% of all the loans that the Florentine government are taking out is with the Bank of the Medici. And what that allows the Medici to do is to control the politics of Florence. So they start building patronage networks across the city. They start buying off officials. They start influencing what laws get passed. And slowly but surely, informally, despite very rarely holding public office, the Medici family come to be the unofficial rulers of Florence. All the important decisions are no longer being made in the palace of the Signoria. They are now being made at the Medici house.
Back on earth, onward, to victory.
And so this massive accumulation of capital in the hands of the Medici specifically and the Florentine bankers more generally had a huge impact on the cultural explosion that we call we have come to call the Renaissance. So the Medici in particular, and the other bankers as well, were huge patrons of public art and public discourse and culture in general. So for example, when the Neoplatonist scholars want to set up the Florentine Academy, modeled on the original Academy of Aristotle, it's the Medicis who pay for it.
Wow. So nice of them to do that out of the goodness of their hearts.
The Medicis, I would say, fund the careers of most of the Ninja Turtles.
About Master Splinter. I mean, he's living in a sewer.
Yeah, well, Master Splinter has different political affiliations. Wow. I always thought that Master Splinter would be with the Chompy.
Yeah, fair. He was a hardcore communist. He was. He's disenfranchised.
He was a rat.
Yeah. Communist, a Marxist rat.
So, why were they spending all this money on art? Well, patronage of public art, specifically, can be understood as a form of what's called conspicuous consumption. That's where spending habits are intended as a signal to your peers that you got the fucking dough. And it's very important to understand that, as we've talked about, the economic world of Florence is incredibly competitive. There's always a chance that one of your competitors will strike a better deal with one of the sunburned Dutchmen who are bringing your wool than you do.
And
undercut your business model. So everybody needs to be projecting constantly.
Well, it's not that hard to imagine. I live in sort of semi-suburban London. I can't step outside of my house without almost getting hit by someone in a Range Rover. An expensive, illogical...
A Chelsea tractor or a white Range Rover. Those are the worst ones.
Exactly. A car, and it's in America, it's probably the same, but it's a massive Ford.
Except they're 50% bigger.
Fucking lifted pickup truck with like no bed and a cab that can fit a large American suburban family. And no one is using these cars for their original purposes.
It can fit your fat children in the back, in the bed, and nothing else.
Exactly. But everyone has to know. You're rich.
Exactly. And so commissioning public art is a way to do that. Because everybody will see, well, you know, Cosimo di Medici must be a wealthy man because his name and his coat of arms are up there in the fucking Duomo.
Yep.
And also, I should say, commissioning works for the church is particularly useful because that will shorten your time in purgatory. So it's a double whammy of self-interest. So, this following declaration goes out to all the fucking unbearable statue heads on Twitter who I have to look at every goddamn day. The great men of the Renaissance were not commissioning art because they had an intuitive understanding of the beauty of nature and God's creation or whatever. They were in a dick measuring competition.
And if that sounds overly cynical, as I'm sure a lot of the statue heads would say, that's because it's true.
Well, don't trust me. Take Richard Goldthwait, who is I know this is an appeal to authority, but we're running out of time, so I have to make this anyway. Richard Goldthwaite, probably one of the most influential of any of this whole cast of Florentinists that I mentioned at the start of this show, who says, for affluent artistic patrons in Renaissance Italy, quote, spending money on art expressed their sense of what constituted noble status. Their spending habits arose from what is perhaps the universal desire of the rich to utilize their wealth to set themselves apart from the common people.
Was that Billy Crystal?
And it's important to note that these rich men were new men. They couldn't lean on their aristocratic connections. A lot of them were just guys who'd struck it rich, like the Medicis. They weren't knights for the most part. And so essentially they had even more of a reason to commission art specifically, because that shows that you're cultured. Before we go on, I just need to say, like, so much of revisionist historiography is just written off as, oh, you're one of the fun police.
Yeah,
like, you can still like this art. A lot of it is still fantastic and is incredibly pathbreaking, but you have to acknowledge the engine that sort of is powering it is the exploitation of working people.
Yes. Specifically to make the rich people look better amongst their peers and make themselves more money.
The reason why the Florentines were the pathbreakers in the Renaissance is because they were the first people to build a capitalist economy.
As we've alluded to before, there you can't have profit and wealth at this scale without someone on the bottom getting screwed over.
Let's talk about the people on the bottom.
Yes, we've set the scene. We've established this sort of agglomeration of different industries and guilds that funneled a lot of money towards the top and gave a group of people a very vested interest in their continued ability to profit off of the banking system and off of these different industries, and perhaps less consideration for the people who are actually making this possible with their labor.
Because as I talked about before, it's a shit situation to be in. You're not making an awful lot of money if you're a wool carder. In Florence, you have no political rights because you can't join a guild, and you also can't bargain collectively, and increasingly your wages are being set by increasingly bureaucratic centralized systems, which screw you over even more. Happily, however, people didn't take that lying down. In 1378, an event known as the Tumulto di Ciompi, the Revolt of the Ciompi, the Revolt of the Wool Carders, occurred. Now, this was a part of, I should say, a wider set of risings across Europe. Wat Tyler, for example, and the Peasants' Revolt in England being a sort of sibling of this.
I actually was reading about one period in Swedish history when, in 90 years, I think there were 13 peasant revolts. Peasants were not happy with the king in Sweden at that time.
No.
And speaking of England, it's important to mention that, like, this is not specific to Florence, although it's particularly acute in Florence, because what are the English people doing? Well, they're raising and shearing the sheep, and around the same time, we're seeing an increase in something called enclosure, where the people, before the Norman conquest, before 1066, people, basically, Anglo-Saxon land law specified that it was, specified that land ownership was mostly based on precedent. So, there was a lot of common land, very little ownership, very hard to deprive someone of their land. And basically, everyone was going, oh, me and this guy and this other guy have been letting our sheep graze on this land forever, so that's our right. And it just carries on. And it just carries on like that. And then the Normans showed up and said, well, actually, you guys ever heard of a little thing called taxes and private ownership? And over the course, around the same time, actually, Florence was beginning to shift away from buying English wool, because mm-hmm. English wool was getting really stupidly expensive. One of the reasons for that was because people were having their land taken away from them and were being forced to pay extortionate rents.
And also, there is an attempt, especially in the closing periods of the Middle Ages, to develop a domestic sort of English wool industry. So starting to do some of those, do some of the hard work of sort of producing the wool and the garments in-house, basically, which screws Florence even more and will eventually doom them to irrelevance by the sort of end of the 17th century. But coming back to the Ciompi, so amidst industrial decline, amidst the aftermath of the Black Death, amidst wider sort of poor harvests across Europe, the working classes, and I use that term pretty much in the modern sense, because I think we've established that there was what we would now consider to be an urban working class in Florence in this period, start organizing, and they start rebelling. And in 1378, they do rise up, and they win. A guy called Michele di Alando leads a workers' revolt, which overthrows the Signoria. Michele di Alando, by the way, is a fantastically ambiguous character. We don't know anything about his life before the revolution, because he was an ordinary guy. He was a wool carter who was married to a butcher, and he was just a foreman in his local workshop.
God, I wish I had a hot Italian butcher wife.
You need to stop. Okay, you're getting a bit feral today.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, DiLando, he's a wool carter and a former soldier and a foreman, and the workers' revolt succeeds, and he gets elected as the Gonfalonieri. And he installs his own signoria and starts passing laws to recognize the workers' guild. He sets up a guild for workers, which is a guild, unlike the other guilds, is a guild of class, not of occupation, which is incredibly interesting, because that is not replicated anywhere else in Europe. And so that creation of that guild enfranchises more people probably than have been able to participate in politics for more than 1,000 years in Italy. And it all goes well for about 40 days. He passes all this hugely consequential legislation, but he eventually is caught in this awful bind that I think a lot of revolutionary governments end up in, where the elite, who've not gone away, they've been deposed, but they're still very much in the city, are putting enormous pressure on him to compromise. Simultaneously, though, he's also under pressure from the radicals among the workers for him to go further, to basically keep sticking it to the elite. And di Lando makes a gamble where he basically sides with the elites and crushes a workers' revolt. His government is left to sort of trail on for another 4 years, but never really achieves anything else after that. And then eventually he's overthrown and goes into exile in 1382. Fun fact about Michele di Lando is that he walked around barefoot in the Signoria Palace, just like so powerful.
Then I will pay my vow.
This has huge sort of ramifications for culture in Florence. This traumatizes the Florentine elites, for example. So they basically lock arms and become incredibly resistant to workers' demands. There's a great quote from the Bishop of Florence, who's installed after the defeat of the Ciompi government, which is, you know, if you want stability, you need to keep Florentines hungry for bread. If people are starving, they can't politically organize. It's something that people in Florence are thinking about for well over 100 years afterwards. One of the people who's writing about the Ciompi revolt is Machiavelli, who surprisingly is quite, I think, pro-Ciompi in the sort of subtext of what he says, because it's very hard to trust any of the sources from around the Ciompi revolt, because all of them are incredibly pro-elite. This is a huge challenge that, like, scholarship is still dealing with. It's very hard to figure out what things actually mean. But Machiavelli, and I should stress, this is writing 100 years afterwards. This is not based on anything. In one of his books, he writes about He writes a speech, basically, from the perspective of a Ciompi leader that I think gives voice to ordinary people in a way that we very, very, very rarely get to
get to hear about in the Middle Ages, because, you know, their shit just didn't survive. So I'm going to read two quick excerpts from this speech. Do not let their antiquity of blood dismay you, for all men, having had the same beginning, are equally ancient, and have been made by nature in one mode. Strip all of us naked, and you will see that we are all alike, dresses in their clothes and them in ours, and without a doubt we shall appear noble and they ignoble, for only poverty and riches make us unequal.
That's so based.
I know you'd like this.
Oh, he's based in red pills. I knew it.
He goes on to say, we ought not to take conscience into account, for where there is, as with us, fear of hunger and prison, there cannot and should not be fear of hell. But if you will take note of the mode of proceeding of men, you will see that all those who come to great riches and great power have obtained them either by fraud or by force. And afterwards, to hide the ugliness of acquisition, they make it decent by applying the false title of earnings to things they have usurped by deceit or by violence. And those who, out of either little prudence or too much foolishness, shun these modes, always suffocate in servitude or poverty. For faithful servants are always servants, and good men are always poor.
Wow.
Now again, I have to stress, that is literature. That's not a quote.
Yeah.
But I think that even if we place it in the 15th century context when Machiavelli's writing, rather than the 14th century context, it's still an incredibly radical speech.
Yeah, be radical today to a lot of people.
Oh, hell yeah. So there you go. Not only does the development of capitalism in Florence fuel this blossoming of, you know, of artistic achievement, but it also produces many of the dynamics of class relationships that we are still living with today.
Wow. So there were so many different social and political and economic factors, as we've said, that all collided at warp speed with each other in medieval Florence and led to this really interesting city kind of blossoming, rising very quickly and then falling sort of meteorically.
It blazed the path for the modern world, both in the good ways and the catastrophically bad ways.
Yeah, but because the reach of Florence was so extensive, it wasn't limited like other cities to places that were reachable by sea, or places that shared, you know, cultural or linguistic links. It was pretty ubiquitous in Europe, and because of a lot of these people that were rising to power and exploiting other people so they could keep a hold on that power, and also just because of all of these insane events that were going on in Florence around this time, you can imagine why Florence and Florentines would be on people's minds and might be
living rent-free in people's heads.
And might be the people you would want to make jokes about. Although, of course, I think anyone who's from somewhere has made a joke about someone who's from the region next door. You know? So, of course,
I'm sure they still make jokes about Florentines in, like,
oh, definitely.
Turin.
Yeah, exactly. So even though, of course, there are, you know, political and cultural factors, it'll always be funny to be like, oh yeah, people from similar town to me an hour away are so stupid. It's just comedy gold.
It's like me and Trinette.
Yes, definitely.
My heart shall pray to thee, shall be.
Well, thank you so much for listening to this episode. I hope you've enjoyed this jaunt through medieval Florence and
whistle stop tour. We've barely scratched the surface. I didn't even get to talk about the bonfire or the vanities, not the movie.
There will be time.
One day.
And we also want to issue a hearty thank you to all of our listeners for sticking with us until episode 10 of the podcast, for all of your kind comments. And your reviews and your constructive feedback about our audio quality, which has hopefully improved
dramatically.
I've learned a lot about audio editing. But seriously, thank you guys so much. It's been so, so much fun working on this podcast so far, and we love all of you guys, and we're so excited to make some more podcasts for you.
Yeah, I mean, we rarely get so real on the show, but it's been a very, very surreal experience, and, you know, I wouldn't be putting the hours in that I do to make this show if I wasn't doing it for the if the love that you've all shown for this wasn't the motivation.
Yeah,
because God knows it's not making me money.
And yeah, as always, we are always very, very thankful if you drop us a 5-star review, leave us a comment, put something in the Spotify feedback box, and maybe if it catches our eye, we will read it out on the podcast, as Aran is about to do.
Yeah, so we got a lot of comments on the vampires episode. Happy Halloween, by the way. And we got this very spooky message from a listener. I was listening on my bike at night under heavy rain when you said we had to listen in the dark. Nothing, just thought it was cool. It was cool. It was cool just to hear about that.
By the way, I, as some of you know, I have a merch shop where I sell like tote bags and stickers and stuff, and I just wanted to say, whichever one of you, actually, I know who it is. Whoever left, the person that left the comment on their order in the notes box that said, I'm going to have sex on top of this tote bag and there's nothing you can do to stop me. First of all, you're unhinged. Second of all, why would you say that to someone after giving them your address? I know where you live. I'm gonna come for you. No, 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 not that. I'm gonna hurt you.
She's not gonna do that, okay? You're not gonna hurt anyone.
No.
In more important news, by the time you are listening to this, Olivia's book will have come out.
Yes, it's coming out on November 2nd, so unless one of us gets hit by lightning while editing this podcast, it will have come out yesterday.
Wow.
So thank you so much to everyone who's pre-ordered the book. It's seen a lot of success so far. It was the book of the month, one of the books of the month in August on bookshop.org, and it's been in the Amazon charts recently, and it's not even out yet. So it's so amazing to see, and I'm just so, so grateful to everyone that's been so supportive and so excited for it and has pre-ordered it already. And yeah, you can buy it now. It's out now. So if you or someone else that you know wants a cheeky, humorous, and interactive guide to the medieval world, then you know where to look.
Imagine this podcast, but better.
No. Wrong. And I think that's about it for today.
Well, yeah. I mean, so you can always find Olivia at Weird Medieval everywhere.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
I am at Aran P. Tappers on Twitter, and at Aran on Blue Sky, because yes, I got in there so quick.
So good. And my personal Twitter is at Olivia_MS. And on that wonderful note, I think it's time for us to finish drinking our birra morettis and eat some spaghetti and think about medieval Florence.
Mamma mia.
Here we go again. Back to my ancestral heartland of Tuscany to discover what made it so horrible that my ancestors moved to the Bronx in 1352.
Your great, 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 great.
Keep going.
Great, great, great.
Almost there.
Great, 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 great. Grand cousin.
Yes. Yes. My great times a thousand grandfather's second cousin's former roommate moved to the Bronx in 1352.